Happy Gay Pride Month, everyone. This is Mathias for Makeup, and I'm so excited because today I'm going to take you behind the scenes with me in LA at Dragcon 2019. For those of you who have been following me here on my YouTube channel for months or even years, you know that I am part of the LGBTQ community, and I feel that it's very important for all of us to come together and find acceptance in all forms of beauty, shape, size, nationality, skin tone, age. I don't feel that there should be prejudice amongst any group. I feel that we are all together in this community of love and we should support each other. Here on my YouTube channel, I try very hard to showcase women from all different backgrounds, and I want this to be a place where you can find someone that you feel connected to, whether it's someone that you look like or someone that says something that really keys into what you are feeling in the moment. Whether it's on my Monday Makeup Chat series where I have a fellow guest star and we discuss things in beauty and skincare and fashion, or in my Beauty Tutorials for Women Over 40 playlist, where I showcase many of the VIP clients who have come to me for a private beauty seminar. You may not know that I also have another playlist called The Many Faces of Mathias for Makeup. In that playlist, I have shown you so many different transformations that I've done on myself over the course of my 20-year career. For those of you who did not know this, I started out as a female impersonator when I was 17 years old. I learned how to do makeup through the art of drag transformation. If it wasn't for drag, I wouldn't be where I am today. Much of the inspiration and spark to be a creative entity in this world came from my community of trans performers, drag performers, and gender-bending artists. I share many of my tips and tricks with you here on my YouTube channel, as well as in my private VIP seminars, and I was so excited to go to Dragcon 2019 this year for the very first time. Can you believe that I've never been to Dragcon? I don't know why I was dragging my feet for so many years. It was an incredible experience. I met so many people, I took so many pictures, and I even vlogged. So in today's exclusive video, I'm gonna take you with me and my friends to Dragcon so you can see how much fun it is, and hopefully you will find it in your hearts to come next year if you're in Los Angeles or if you're in New York, anywhere that Dragcon may show up. I'm excited to share this vlog with you because it's International Gay Pride Month, June 2019, and I have so many exciting things to share with you on my channel for the month.
So I'm gonna ask you guys later, I'm gonna ask specific things about each of you, but I'm dying to know about this because Tootsie is a Broadway musical now. And Tootsie, and it's very fun, and Santina Fontana is doing an amazing job in the Dustin Hoffman role. What is your take, though, each of you, on what I like to call hetero drag, which is Tootsie, Sound Like It Hot, Bosom Buddies, every TV show in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, basically, that we're talking about. Films and TV shows where men, through some cockamamie circumstance, find themselves in women's clothing, and before the first commercial, another straight guy has fallen in love with them, almost usually. What's your take on straight guy drag? Or let's just read Boy George.
For a long time though, that was all we had. And so it's like, you go back to like Jodie on Soap, and I think about, you know, the trans representation and things like that, and it was so insulting the way they wrote that character, but it was all that they would, it was the only thing you had. And so it was like a mixed blessing, I guess, because now you look back on it and you cringe and you think how horrible it all was, but at the time it was still sort of, it was that baby step you needed to open the door, maybe a little more?
I think so.
Yeah, there's some of the things, I mean, like, I watched Sound Like It Hot just a few years ago again, and it still holds up, and it's not offensive, so some things are and they aren't. It's weird how history will tell you, because it's like, it's such a beautiful ending in that movie where it's like, nobody's perfect. It's like, it's lovely, and like, they're also such good actors, they never joke. I think that the key is, the joke is never, I'm a dude in a dress. And when that's it, that's like where it gets kind of murky and weird. Or when the straight guy that falls into it always runs to the toilet to throw up. Like, it's like, oh, no, dude, no, what? Like, that whole thing.
It's like, a Family Guy.
That's where I get like, ugh. But whereas, I don't know, and a lot of people have different opinions about the new Tootsie musical, but they call all of that into attention, and I think it's great. I think the new show is fantastic, and it's also, because it deals with how men and women treat each other. It's more than it is about, really, about drag queens. It's about, when he has to be a woman, he learns to be sensitive, he learns to care about other people, you know, he learns to be a better person by being a woman, and so we celebrate femininity. So I think when they learn that lesson, it's great. It's just that when it's like, look how gross this is, that's where it comes from.
We don't, a lot of times we have an argument now where, you know, should LGBT roles be played by LGBT actors?
Right.
And that's something that's a really important conversation to be having now, but I don't think in the 60s or 70s we could have had that conversation, so you couldn't have ever gotten the show made or the story told if you used an LGBTQ actor. So you had to have a straight person do it. And so, I mean, the times have changed, and now thank God we're in a place where we have, you know, LGBT actors who can play these roles.
Well, and the history of drag is rife with people who defended their masculinity, would have fist fights if you said they were anything but heterosexual, all that bullshit.
I also think we're in a better position now to, I worked on a TV show years ago called New York Undercover, and they had written a scene where I'm this big drag queen, and all of a sudden I'm sitting playing cards with other drag queens and have to say I'm really a straight guy. And I said, that's ridiculous. Say that. And they said, well, the writers are in LA and they're not going to be awake for a few hours, so you have to say we're not. And I stopped filming. And I would never do that now. I don't have the balls to do that. Back then I was so young, I didn't understand. But I stood my ground. I said, I'm not going to go on TV playing this drag queen saying I'm straight. You're talking about something completely different, and that's not what I'm playing. So they did change it for me. But I think even in the short, well, the 20, 30 years I've been doing drag, it's just so much has changed, and I think we're just in a better position now to represent ourselves and educate people as to who we are.
Coco, let's follow up. I want to follow up and ask you about that. You did Will and Grace, the original incarnation of it, and I can't believe this, in 2001, right? And now, 17 years later, again, we've seen you last year and this year, again, as and the first one I saw was listed as Lawrence, was the name of the character, and now it's Miss Coco, as herself, or whatever it's listed as. How did things change in terms of the character, and also in terms of how we were treated?
Well, I wasn't really, and then first episode, it was just that opening little bit. It wasn't very long. The one thing I remember was they had me get into makeup and in like 30 seconds. And I said, you know, queens across America are going to be like, that's impossible. That could never happen. But they didn't care. So
it's the Jetsons approach.
Right. Exactly. What I noticed was that the first time I was on the show, although you're walking into people who are so great at their jobs and so professional, there was a little, certain people on the crew when I didn't know how to deal with drag. And who plays Karen? What's her name?
Megan,
I think, was probably the one that was the most open to me, curious and asking questions. And this time around, I walked in and everyone knew who I was, and Coco, and so good to have you back, or they knew my YouTube videos, and it was like, they were hip to drag all of a sudden. And also, I could play a character that was no longer living with his mom, but who was married, who owned a bar, who was a functioning, you know, human being, as opposed to, I think, how I was presented the first time, which was fine with me. I was on the show, you know. But I did notice a difference with everyone on the crew, as well as just how it was written. Yeah, I mean, I remember the first go-around with Will and Grace, they didn't even really allow men to kiss on that show.
Right.
You know, that was a thing that the writers were constantly trying to push, and the big wigs would, you know, pull them, rein them in. And so I think the fact that I played the drag, and in that last episode, I'm in the airport in full drag, and that would really never happen. But, you know, it's just great that they don't care.
Now it was that you have to have seen it. It's heaven. It's so when you show it, the audience is like, yay! You know, it's Elton John or Bette Midler shows up.
What was great was they told me when I made my entrance on the first episode of this new season, there was a huge eruption of applause and these queens in the audience screaming, and one of the actresses backstage thought that Sean had just made his entrance. And she said, "Ooh, he got big applause tonight." Coco Peru.
one of the reasons things have changed, and Miss Coco gets to own a bar and have a husband on a show like that. Not only is the work that she's done, but also the effect of RuPaul's Drag Race showing us drag queens with full lives.
You know, you can't underestimate the impact that show has had. And I work at World of Wonder, and so I see the way the fans react and everything. But when it went from Logo to VH1 in season 9 or whatever like that, and it opened it up to a whole new worldwide audience. And the way that drag is just, I mean, when you walk outside here and you just see the kids and the grandparents and the little 12-year-olds, and it's a magical time. I mean, we live in dark times. I mean, this is a seriously fucked up era to be living in, but we make so many strides forward. It's really exciting in that respect.
I'm with you. I think it's like drag is saving the world when you walk out there. It feels really amazing to do it. Now, Leslie, you just finished up a run on The Cool Kids, and you were so funny and naughty and sexually active and everything one wants in a character, and got me in a lot of trouble. But when you've also done truly the most amazing Tammy Wynette impersonation on Sorted Lives, the series, the movies, and everything. What was it like doing that character, doing Brother Boy? Well, people are, particularly Southern people, are obsessed with Brother Boy.
It's such a wonderful story, and I'll do the quick version, but I sent Dale Shores a book of short stories by Bobby Ann Mason, who's a favorite writer of mine out of Kentucky. And she writes these short stories, and I said, you know, Dale, you could write short stories. He wrote me back and wrote, I said, you know what I could? He wrote back, and there was a short story called the Nicotine Fit, and it's got these three women trying to bury their mother and quit smoking. And then he wrote another one called The Decomasexualization of Brother Boy, which had nothing to do with the other one, and sent that to me. But it wasn't for me or about me or anything. It's about this, Kevin Wynette obsessed guy that was in the mental hospital. And then he sent me this one about this woman who busts into a bar and holds her husband. She takes too many Valiums and she holds her husband hostage and makes him put on a bra because he's cheating on her. Then he called me and said, I've put them all together into a play. Then he did a reading in his living room. Now, the next day we met at the dog park because we have dogs, and I looked at him and said, oh, honey, it's awful. It's just awful. Now, in my defense, there wasn't the funeral scene, which seems to pull it all together, and there wasn't the Betsy May character, which was Olivia Newton-John, who sings and won. But anyway, then he said, I'm going to put it up on play, and he would call me, and I would read me things, and I would... The point being, seldom does an actor at my level get that much input into a character, where I do, you know. I remember the day that we opened at Theater, which was the corner of... Hollywood Boulevard. And I was a clean sober then, but even though it's a long story, I'd go down and drink at, what was the bar?
Spotlight!
Maybe a little line of crystal, but anyway. Because Brother Boy only had one line at the very end. He had to say, I don't even remember. Mama, I guess you leaned over the casket. I guess you didn't think I was going to come, Mama. But anyway, what's the point? So one night, Olivia Newton-John showed up. We knew her sister, Rona, was in a playwriting class with all of us. Olivia showed up and said to Dale, if you ever make a movie of this, I want to play the lesbian. We said, oh my God. Off her name, we were able to raise $800,000, which is not even low budget, it's like no budget. And we videotaped it. But like not like high def. We videotaped it.
So I hope you enjoyed this sneak peek into my DragCon experience. If you want to see more behind the scenes moments in my professional life, please consider joining me on Patreon, where every month as a loyalty member, you'll gain access to exclusive behind the scenes videos, long form educational video tutorials for women of all ages and nationalities that I'm not producing and releasing here on my YouTube channel. And you'll also be able to earn rewards such as either discounts to my online face-to-face beauty video tutoring services, or even earn your own free 60-minute long face-to-face video chat tutoring session with me as your beauty mentor. All of the reward tiers are easily listed and described for you to be able to choose what will fit within your budget and how much you want to support me on a month-to-month basis. I have a ton of products here in my beauty studio that I will never open because I have more makeup than I know what to do with, so I also offer free beauty box giveaways for my loyal monthly Patreon members. If you have a comment or a question, please leave it down below. I can't wait to hear from you in the comments. I read each and every single one. Please follow me on all my social media at mathias4makeup. And if you want to see exactly how I got this look, please stay tuned to my YouTube channel by subscribing and clicking on that little box right down there at the bottom that looks like a bell, so your notifications will pop up with my two brand new videos every single week, because coming up this month, I'm going to be breaking down this look and showing you exactly how I achieved it, using my pro makeup artist tips, tricks, and techniques. Happy Pride Month once again. I love you all for watching, and remember to find the beauty within your heart and soul, find compassion for every single person on the planet, and remember, try to practice acceptance for your neighbors just as you would for your family and your friends. I love you all for watching, and to all my LGBTQ community, mwah, I hope you have a beautiful year. Bye for now.